Let me ask you this morning. Are you excited? Are you excited? Are you excited? What? My kids excited? Maybe going to the beach? Going to the circus? Are you excited? Right? Alright. Those can be excited too. About what? Maybe a friend has come to be excited. Maybe coming together just to do something fun. Maybe a football game. All excited about that. Baseball game.
Now, as they spoke
near Jerusalem. And the second part is because they thought the kingdom of God would appear immediately. They were so excited. Jesus says, calm down. I have something to tell you. Therefore, he said, a certain nobleman went to a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and then to return. What do you see in this verse? Time. No, there's not a time in there. It's a journey. And it doesn't say when you return. So what do we do? This good man, this noble in the story, was gone. And so he gave money and orders. So he called 10 of his servants to come and deliver to them 10 minutes. He said, these coins, as he gave them to them, and what did he say? Did he say, did he was leaving? He said, no, he says, what are you going to do with this for me? A minute. It's a sort of a funny word. But it means 10 ounces of silver. So that would about be 3 months of wages. It'd be a lot of money. Maybe take 20. But as he gave the coins, then he left. And he followed what? Do business. There's another word here, occupy. The King James Bible says, do business. Several years ago, there was this group called Occupy. They changed the meaning of it. And that's not what applies to this story today. The English is going to change. We see the relationship to the rebellion of the Occupy group. They were against the rich, if you remember. Against Wall Street. What did they do? They marched. They went there trying to take the place, that rebellion that they had. They broke glass windows. They turned cars over. They opened them. They didn't do any bad things. It was the opposite. They were preventing business. They were not doing business. So we see here that this fits in English better for us. What kind of business? We see here in the Greek, where we're saying that this meaning of doing business, of increasing. The point was that this man gave them and then he left. He wanted to see an increase when he came back. He wanted them to see be faithful in what they did, if they were people. If a banker loses money and doesn't increase, his boss is there on him if he doesn't do well. Was here in verse 14. The people of the nation there hated him, this man. What did they do? Well, they chose a group of people who sinned and followed after him and said, we will not have this man joining over us. Get out, leave. Get away. We don't like you. So we see. So, he returned, having received the kingdom, and he commanded his servants to whom he had be on. Wanted to know how much they had made in their business, and wanted to see what they had done, if they had done business for them. You see, two servants. The first one came. He says, then came the first who said, Master, I've increased your money, and now I have 10. Master says, good. Now you have 10 kingdoms. And the second came, said, Master, your money has increased, and now I have 5. Good job. You can rule over this city. You see, these two have been faithful. They believed that he would come. They were obedient. But another one came. He had 10 initially. And we see the report of 3. We don't know about the other 7. But the third that came up and said, I put away my handkerchief because I feared you, because you are an austere man. You collect what you did not deposit, and weep what you did not sow. Wow. And the good man that the nobleman said, with your own mouth, I will judge you. You know that I was an austere man, collecting what I did not deposit, putting money, what I had lost and sold, the deposit of the bank. Then you came back, you took my money, and there's no interest in it. He said to the people around, take the money from him and give it to the servant who now has the 10. Why? Well, he's got 10 already. Why does he need more? Because everyone who has will give more. And those who have not, what they have will be taken. The good report was rewarded. The bad report was punished. And then in verse 27, my enemies, bring them here. Those who do not want me to reign over them and slay them before him. And so we see the disciples saying, the kingdom is coming. The story is about the one who didn't do what was right. He put it off in this land, in this time. But it tells us clearly about these things. So the question is, who is this noble? We see the noble, how this story relates. And so who is this? This is Jesus, the noble. Where is Jesus? Where is he now? He is going to heaven. He is not here. He is there. Is he going to stay there? When does he come back? We don't know. But when he comes back, and establishes the kingdom here. And at that right time, he will come. And those who wanted to establish the kingdom then, it was too late. It wasn't time yet. We're waiting yet for that to happen. It's interesting here, the stories here in chapter 19, of the people who didn't like that man, who didn't want anything to do with him. There, just before that, as he would come back. And when no one came back, you will find the ones who are faithful. When Jesus comes back, you will find those who are faithful. They may not be many. Because most people were against him. See, the two that were obedient and believed interesting how they were born. You see them, they didn't all accept him. But some of them. You know, the right time. You know, we don't know when Jesus will come back. But we know he will. We know it's a good time, a good thing. He will come and establish the kingdom. As we look about that, as he comes to rule into the kingdom, he will say, those will be cast in, some will be saved and some will be cast in his fire. We see the, how that comes in with the story here in chapter 19. Okay. We see those who don't do anything, those who turn away, those who do the living of Jesus, the responsibility that we have to him, and the gifts that he's given us, the skills that he's given us, the things that he's given us to keep us. And he wants us to then increase with that, our church, the witness that others, that we would take up that business of saving people with the word of God, with the gospel, and spread it. It's our responsibility to do that. We don't know when he's coming, but we know he will judge. So what do we do while we're here? The increase of those who are faithful. Now, what's the point? Here we are with him. And Jesus told this to the disciples long ago, yet we see in that that today it still applies to us. How is that? It says those who do business, to do good. I'm curious here. No, I'm not trying to hurt anybody. I don't want to scare you. I don't want you to be afraid. I don't want to push you down. That's not the point. But the question here is to ask, who are the top 5 leaders in this church? You know, you have an opinion. Well, my name's not there. No. You know, God, when we look here at these top 5 leaders, have a videotape I want to show you. I want you to look. Are you ready to see it? Okay?
One day, I was driving on the freeway. I was going to work. And so I got tapping on the shoulder and saying, you need to teach deaf children. And I'm like, I'm not skilled. No. You know, I teach overdubs, but children, no. I kept driving. I forgot, okay. And next week on Sunday, I went to the pastor and I said, I want to teach deaf children. And he was so surprised. So I went in, I was ready for my class, and ever since, it's been around 36 years.
Your children, very sweet. I love to see them and their excitement, the love of things. Can you see the joy in Julie? Can you see serving God, doing the business for Him that happened within? The joy was there inside as she was serving the Lord. Julie was doing that work for Him.
Thank you.
go on. But let's look at the point here. We talk about the dead church. Now, we love our mother church, First Baptist, Second Baptist, Towers of Baptist. There are many good churches all around us here. We're not being critical here, but here at Woodhaven, it's different. It's a deaf church. And that's special, that's unique. It's not like other churches. You see, in other churches, there's an interpreter. They're trying to copy that interpreter. But as being established as a deaf church is different. Being involved in a deaf church is wonderful. It's exciting. It's good. A deaf church is wonderful. It's different than a hearing church. It's true. A deaf church. Mission. It's a mission. Mission to go to Ukraine, to go on mission to work, but we have a mission here as well, as a deaf church. We have an opportunity to take the word, to summon it with power. That's wonderful. See here, taking the word of God, taking it. Explain that concept. The Lord God taking that word and making it something that can be seen different than other churches. I'm being critical of any other church, but it's different. We're trying to make it fit the net. Culture is different. We're different. We have an opportunity, and our responsibility to train others to work, to be patient and encouraging, to teach them through their culture, through their language. It's amazing. It's different. As we're here in this mission work,
a special mission, maybe crossing cultures,
to say, hey,